Hello everyone, we're back talking about Rust, and in particular web development. So in one of my previous videos, I said that even though I love the language, I'm not sure that Rust is the best choice for web development, at least as of now. Of course, there are people with a very different opinion, so to finally answer this question, I decided to invite a special guest, Luca Palmieri. He's an experienced developer with strong contributions in the Rust ecosystem, and he has also shipped several Rust web services to production within his company. But most importantly, he's the author of Zero to Production, a book with the goal of teaching you how to build production-ready Rust web services. A short disclaimer before starting, I did not receive any money to talk about this book, I just thought it was a very interesting topic to cover on the channel. So without further ado, let's dive right into our conversation. Hi Luca, thank you very much for joining us today.
Hi Federico, thanks a lot for having me, it's my pleasure.
Would you like to introduce yourself a bit first so that our viewers can get a better idea of who you are and what you do?
Sure thing. My name is Luca. I've joined what I call the tech industry in the last 3 or 4 years, pretty much. Mathematician, machine learning engineer, software engineer, that's more or less the parable. And I guess relevant to the audience, I was starting with Rust about 8 years ago, pretty much. Starting with open source stuff, machine learning, more recently, backend development. So that's where I am at the moment.
Great. So, as I said in the intro, even though I love the language, I'm not sure Rust is the best choice for web development as of now, because compared to other languages such as Node.js or Go, the ecosystem doesn't seem mature enough. So you clearly have another opinion. Do you think, so can you please explain why and most importantly when Rust could be a good choice for web development?
Definitely. You might wonder, that's a question I get asked a lot. you're completely right. Like, the ecosystem maturity is, of course, at a different point when you compare Rust with something like Node, Go, or even like Python or PHP. Like, different choices have massive ecosystems, massive developer adoption, and where generally you go off the shelf and do stuff. Like, you need to build a project, the amount of code you actually need to write that is not core to what you want to build is really, really small if you are in those languages. Rust is a little bit of a more adventurous choice, I would say. But it still has a space. So as you know, we've been using Rust professionally year to day at this point for 6 months to build some really interesting systems. And what drew us to the language, apart from me being a very annoying advocate, was the power of the type system, was the amount of expressivity that the type system gives you why you need to model complex domains. And that's, in a way, like the bulk of the work that we do. Like, Rust, of course, has like niches that it targets very aggressively, right? So you can go system programming, embedded, game development. For all these use cases, Rust has a compelling choice. And that always rotates around performance and being able to express certain types of states. When you do backend development, and what I like to call enterprise software, the complexity is not really necessarily in the computer science of what you're doing, it's in the type of processes that you try to model, which sometimes can get very, very complicated. I mean, because they get legacy, they change over times, or they're not fully understood. Rust gives you the strongest type system out there in a non-functional language. Like, to get the same level of expressivity, you would have to go to use Haskell or use Haml. Instead, Rust gives you the best of that world without most of the jargon. It gives you the productive bits for those functional type systems. And that's the most important reason. Like, if you have something complex to model, then enums, such as bag types, errors, values, all those things help you actually encode a lot of that domain understanding that you build yourself into the software, which is in the end what you need, because when the next developer picks up that piece of software, they don't need to wonder, oh, okay, what was he thinking here? Most of it is written inside. And that comes back to the fact that most software is more read than written. So if you can get a lot of information in there, that's for the benefit of you and the person who comes next. So yeah, type system number one, then the performance of NAS, right? Like, if you write something and it runs fast, or even better, which is more important for us, consumes less resources and is predictable, all those things are nice buses. And you get this like full stack So you use it for this, but if tomorrow you need something to be really, really fast, you don't have to change that much. But you need to add another tool to the stack. You pick the same tool and you repurpose it to do the other things you need. So I think that's my pitch.
Great. Thank you. To cover the other side, when do you think Rust is not a good choice?
Why is Rust not a good choice? Definitely front-end development feels at this point in time for me too adventurous to actually be productive. I think WebAssembly is nice and it's going to be revolutionary and all these nice things that we say about it. But if you've got to write a front-end today, Rust is probably not the best choice. Unless you have some very custom and peculiar requirements, I think existing ecosystems cover you much better at this point in time.
So I saw that in your book, you choose Actix as the framework of choice. Why did you choose it over other alternatives such as Rocket, for example?
Okay, I'll preface that by saying I love everybody and everything I say now will be used against me. I think Actix, in a word, is a solid web framework. Like, I believe that the likelihood of me being the likely chap that goes and find a critical bug in the web framework with Actix Web is very, very low. And that's pretty much the bulk of what I ask from a framework. Like, give me some basic facilities to parse HTTP requests, send response over the wires, headers, middlewares, I'll get the rest done. And Actix does that. The middleware part, maybe not as nicely as others, but it does it well as a large community. And as you said before, the ecosystem around it is the biggest at this point in time when it comes to Rust web frameworks. Rocket, Warp, Tide, each of them has strengths. There are things that they do better than the others. Tide probably has the nicest API, if I may say so. Warp has an interesting API, which is a way to say they don't like it, but they think it brings something to the table. Rocket is the most complete, so it tries to do different things. It's the most, like, I think, RailC framework among the ones available, but it's been running on nightly Rust for a long time, which makes it a no-go for production usage and also for book usage. Like, I don't want to go troubleshoot people because the latest nightly broke their Rocket stuff. Like, it's a pain I don't need in my life. Plus, I can't really send people to branches which have not been released software. I'm waiting for Rocket 05 to come out. I'm sure it's going to be great. But today, that's not a viable choice.
Great. Thank you very much. And what were the major obstacles you faced when deploying this Rust web service to production?
Major obstacles. Technically wise, I wouldn't say we had many. So Actix, as I said, gave us most of the building blocks we needed. HTTP-wise, we had to write a few custom things around authorization authentication, but not much more than that. The tracing crate and the tracing ecosystem was another massive boost to productivity, so that covered most of our instrumentation needs. I think the main issue we got was around choosing a toolkit, which I think is, at this point in time, the big obstacle at using Rust in productions. So crates.io, 50,000 crates, magic. There's a lot of very nice stuff in there. What do I use? Like, how do I pick and choose a bunch of tooling that then together gives me a toolkit that makes sense, which I can actually use to ship software? And that has been difficult because, of course, you start a team, as I did at the very beginning. I was the only one with Rust experience. Okay, do I use SQLX, do I use Diesel? What do I use for configuration management? What do I use for validating JWT tokens? Choices, 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 choices. Like, all these things compound. So I would say if you were trying to replicate that experiment, that is definitely one of the biggest obstacles. If you have a person that knows the ecosystem better and they can carve a path, which is kind of steers away from like the troublesome corners, that makes it easier. So I don't know. Don't mix executors. Like, people, oh, why don't we use this library together with this other library? I was like, it's going to be a lot of pain. Steer away from, like, I don't know, libraries that use a lot of type magic and then give you very mysterious errors. And then for newcomers, that's a problem. So we try to optimize for onboarding new people on the project. And that, of course, requires some choices.
Okay. So I have a question regarding this aspect. So many people are scared of Rust because of the steep learning curve. Do you think using Rust can affect collaboration negatively?
That's a very good question. First of all, I'd like to a little bit dispel the myth that Rust is an awesomely complicated language. At this point, I have like data, so I'm going to bring that to the table. Senior devs can pick up Rust in a few weeks. Like, I've seen that consistently at this point more than a couple of times. Arrive, read the book, pick up some stuff around the synchronous, and they can write. Do they know every single nook about the language? No, they don't. They don't need to. They can still be productive locally, like 20-30%. They care about for what they're doing. Junior devs may take a little bit longer, still measurable in a month. So none of that is unheard of, and I think it's more than reasonable if you're making an investment in a technology. I think Rust boosts collaborations in a way, in the sense that, as we discussed before, there's things you can encode in the type system, and those become guardrails, right? Like, I've been in a position in the past of contributing to very large Python code bases. And you're like, okay, there's this little function here. Let me try and change some stuff. But you don't really know what inputs are being passed to that function. And you're like, okay, well, now it doesn't handle lists anymore. You broke it. Like, the implicitness of a lot of these things, the duck typing, the dynamic typing, makes a lot of things much more complicated. In Rust, a lot of things being explicit and a longer thing being checked by the compiler actually makes it easier. So it might make you, it might take you longer to get to a compiling state. So it might take you longer to actually have something that you can run, but the likelihood of you making massive errors that are gonna be having like outsized impact, for example, with a production outage, I feel is much, much lower. And that's the type of like thing that I actually believe promotes collaboration, because it reduces the fear of somebody going to touch pieces of software that usually they wouldn't dream about touching, like frameworks and other like sensitive bits in an application.
Great, thank you very much. And so to end our conversation, did you want to talk a bit more about your book?
I mean, of course, why would I? So the book, what has been now 6 months since I started, Zero's Production in Rust, for those who have not seen it. It started as a book to teach people about using Rust for backend development. I think I realized 2-3 weeks ago, it actually turned out in a book to teach people backend development using Rust. So it slightly shifted the emphasis over time. I think it fills a void, like I would describe it in this way. Most programming books fall in two categories. So that's the book about ideas. So I'm going to show you a lot of things. I'm going to explain to you architectures, design, and so on and so forth. It's not going to be a single line of code in any of the book, and then you're going to figure out yourself how that actually needs to be implemented. Then there's the book about technologies, Rails top to bottom, Laravel top to bottom. And I show you all the nitty-gritty things about the framework, but you actually don't fully understand, or I don't explain to you at least, where those make sense and why do they exist. I think Zero to Production tries to take a slightly different approach, as in, I teach you some stuff about backend development, which is not Rust specific, but I also show you how to actually implement it and a little bit what are your options to get those things and put them in practice using the Rust toolkit. And in a way, I think it reads more or less a pair programming session. It's me and you who start together, we're building a project. It's an email newsletter API. Chapter after chapter, we are working in making it happen. And you learn things. And I think depending on where you're coming from, you might learn more, might learn less. So if you're a backend developer who doesn't know Rust, I think that's a very nice way to pick up the language because you already know the domain, so you pick up just the technology. If you know the tech, but you don't know the domain, that's a very easy way to learn backend development, or at least a nice portion of it. And if you're curious, you can probably pick up both going along the way if you're a little bit more adventurous. But I would say in general, like no matter the background, I believe if you go through the book, there's something you're going to learn, maybe more or less, depending on where you're coming from. But that's more or less the spirit, I would say.
Well, thank you very much. Actually, I've read a chapter of the book, and since then I started using Postgres in my local machine as well instead of SQLite, because you taught me how testing should be done. So yeah, I really see how the book can teach you a lot besides Rust itself. So that said, thank you very much for being with us, and yeah, see you.
Thank you for having me. Bye-bye.
Alright, so that was all for this video. If you are interested in these topics, don't forget to check out the book. The link is in the video description. And if you like the video, don't forget to like it and subscribe to the channel because it really helps, and I hope to see you in the next one.